Hi everyone, I'm Anton Stringer. I'm a senior gameplay designer on Civ 6. I'm here with lead designer Ed Beach, and we're here to play a game showcasing some of the new stuff that we're talking about with Civ 6 today.
And we're really excited to be showing off Civ 6 today. It's a big day, a big week for Civ 6. Everyone has sort of started releasing video content. We've sort of done a press tour worldwide and gotten some of the key community members and press to get a real good look at playing up to 150 turns. And today's the day that they can share all that information with everybody, so it's a big day for us.
Yeah, so a lot of the systems we've been talking about, like active research and the the civics tree, which is we're just starting to talk about kind of more in detail now, and the governments and the district system especially, like now players are starting to see that for the first time. We're getting the reactions. I think it's all very positive so far.
Right, and we had to pick a civilization from the eight that we've announced to live stream to with you guys today, and we decided that the right choice was to go with somebody else who's having a big week this week. And it's a big week for Brazil, just like it's a big week for Civ 6.
Yeah.
And they just got announced yesterday. So brand new information about how they play. So what we've done is a couple days ago, I went ahead and started up a game with Brazil. Mm-hmm. And we had shown a fair amount of detail on like what the first 50 turns or so of a game looked like. But what we wanted to do was get people an idea of what going deeper into the game than that feels like, what it looks like. So now we're going to start. I was going to go all the way till turn 50, but on turn 45, I actually got a real good jump start on getting a religion.
Right.
And so turn 45, I got the first great profit in the game. And so that seemed like a perfect time to stop because we could really explain the way the religion system works and show that off in detail if everyone got to see how you form a religion right from the beginning. The other thing that I thought we would do today is I used to play in Civ 3 succession games. I haven't played a lot of succession games since then, but back in the Civ 3 day, I actually did these. And that
you
the cool thing
save,
about succession games, you get a team of people and someone starts off, and I think it was usually 10 turns. And you play 10 turns, you explain what your rationale for everything was, and then you hand it off to the next player.
It's a new leader in charge.
Right, and you may not get it back the game back for like 50 or 60 turns. Mm-hmm. Lots usually going on by the time you get it back, but it's sort of a fun group way to play the game. So I thought that Anton and I would play this sort of succession game style. I'm going to play 5 turns, hand it back over to Anton. We'll see whether or not he pushes things forward in a even more positive direction. Start to fall apart. But feel free to criticize my moves. I'll do the same with you. We'll
Sounds good.
A little get back and forth and kind of see how things go here. So let's go ahead and start looking at our save. And there are a couple key things to note about this. One is I have already explored the map quite a bit. I sent out scouts in 3 or 4 different directions. So you can see that, probably 15, 20 tiles from our homeland, I've explored a lot of this.
Yeah.
But those scouts didn't survive very well. The barbarians can be really tough in Civ 6. And eventually, even though I think some of those scouts had here's one scout that does have a promotion.
Right, that's good.
But I've lost some scouts and some warriors. I think I've actually lost 4 units total to the barbarians in the first 45 turns, which is definitely more than I used to lose in Civ 5. And we're playing just on regular old Prince difficulty here.
Right.
So
did you make use of that early policy that gives you bonus combat strength?
Maybe not all the time, because I did have a couple scouts around, and so I wanted to trade off that one with the one that gives me double experience with my scouts.
Yeah, that's an important early trade-off.
But once things got heated with the barbarians, I definitely used that. Let's go see what we have in our government tree right now. I have upgraded my government to Classic Republic.
Nice.
So the great thing about that is I'm getting 15% bonus to Great Person Generation, and that bonus will ratchet up the longer I spend here.
Right. That probably helped you with your early profit as well.
Yes. But the downside is I don't have any military policies at all.
No.
So we're getting no bonus against barbarians, and our scouts aren't any earning bonus experience. So
you could use that wild card for it, but yeah, it's a trade-off because there's a lot of wild card
right.
stuff.
And actually, that's a good point, is because in the wild card slot, I have had the great profit generation policy. I don't need that anymore.
Right.
So we should look at making a government change this turn if we can. We have enough gold to do so, and it's five turns until Games and Recreation finishes. So
when the games begin, it's my turn.
That's true. We'll have to decide how expensive that is, though. So let's look at not the great person screen. Let's look at the government screen, and let's see. It's only 35 gold to switch policies right now, and it does free up that wild card slot.
Right.
So moving in the policy with combat against barbarians might be a good move, especially given that we have guys right on our border right now. So actually, I'm going to go ahead and do that. We'll show how that works.
Cool.
So in the policy screen, I'm going to open up my chance to switch out policies, and then I'm going to go ahead and take the... discipline,
runner, yeah.
And put it over my wild card slot. So other policies, we might want to rethink of those at the same time. I've got builder production, and I've got purchase plot discount as well.
Mm-hmm.
Those are probably useful enough. Let's stick with those. But in five turns, you certainly may want to change them out.
I will reform the government.
Yes. Now, the charismatic leader for the diplomatic policy, I think that's pretty much a done deal because we have met a bunch of city-states, but we were the first civ to meet a lot of them, mm-hmm. and so we got our first envoy there.
Right.
And the diplomatic league only helps us with... the first time you establish envoy somewhere, so this one's probably a pretty clear choice at the moment.
Yeah.
Okay, so now we have our combat bonus versus the barbarians. Let's go ahead and we'll do some military action first, and then we'll go ahead and worry about the religion setup. So we've got this archer who's probably our best unit. He promoted from being a slinger. He's got a +5 attack. So let's go ahead and move him down the road from between our two cities. He's not going to get an attack off this turn, but...
Right. And because the road's there, he can kind of waltz right through the rainforest.
Right. Okay, let's go zoom in a little bit. We're a little cramped here because we're playing at a 720 screen resolution for the live stream. So normally you can kind of see things a little bit more clearly. We've got some UI creeping in on us here, but we will make the best of it. So I am going to go ahead and move this warrior over and... It's a little dangerous, but I think...
it's a decisive victory. It'll be fine.
Yeah, and now I got both these guys in place, I can get the flanking bonus.
Right.
So I'm going to go ahead and go for it. The flanking bonus is not something you get automatically in Civ 6. You actually have to earn it by unlocking a civic that's early on. But I had done that before. I was having enough trouble with barbarians. I thought it was crucial to have it.
Yeah, that's one of the many things we kind of like, you know, wanted to... make unlocked by culture. A lot of the unique units, like the Brazil's Minas Gerais battleship unique unit is mm-hmm. unlocked with culture, I think at the nationalism civic. So yeah, there's a lot of things that will help you in combat, things that would normally be in the tech tree that actually come out of
right.
culture.
Anything that we could feel like was sort of like an organizational thing and not like a technology
logistics
thing,
and,
all comes out of the civic tree, and that's another example of that.
Yeah.
Okay, so now we are set to claim our great person, and a little bit tough to see here on the screen.
You can mouse wheel over, I think.
But yeah, there Confucius is going to be our great prophet this time.
Very historical.
Yes. Obviously had a great impact on Brazil.
Yes.
but you can actually see, looking through here, we can peek, and we can see that there are only two other players that have started developing religion at all. England's the furthest along. England and France are the two civs that we've met. We'll mm-hmm. talk about diplomacy in a second. So we got a big jump on the religion game on the AI this time, which is actually unusual in this build. The one thing that this is a build from about a month ago, so there's a lot that's different in like the newest builds that we've been playing. But I remember that in this build, some of the people that were playing at the press and so forth were having trouble getting a religion because the AI was really good at religion. Mm-hmm. We just happened to get a real good jump on it in this game. Okay, so I'm going to recruit that great person, and what we want to do with him is we want to send him to our holy site so he can found the religion. And part of the reason that we're doing so well in the religion game is we've got this really sweet holy site. It's got two mountains on two sides, and for Brazil we have...
Oh.
We're getting a +4 faith adjacency bonus from it. So we'll send him up here, And he will go ahead and found the religion. Oh. And now we have a notification to telling us we want to found a religion. So I will go ahead and be very faithful to Brazil and will found Catholicism.
Fair enough.
And then we have to think about what beliefs we want. So religion, how does it work? It's similar to Civ 5, but sort of everything has been tweaked a little bit. Mm-hmm. So again, religions can have up to four beliefs in them. Mm-hmm. It used to be in Civ 5 that the pantheon belief was built into the religion, and right. Now that's sort of a separate player level attribute. And once you pick a pantheon, even if a major religion comes and sweeps over your civilization, you keep your pantheon bonus.
Sticks with you, yeah.
Which is nice. If you set it, you know, like if you're based in the desert and you want to keep that bonus, it doesn't get wiped out for you when someone's religion comes in.
Yeah, it's something that's nice for me too, because even if I'm not going for a religion game, like sometimes I'll take the God King policy early on, because like grabbing that early pantheon is still very valuable because it'll stick with you throughout the game, yeah. Even if you don't end up getting to get a profit of your
own. And the pantheon that we chose here, I was actually a little infuriated with the AI, because I was like, I'm playing against Brazil, I want to be in the jungle, yeah. I want that sacred path pantheon bonus that's going to double up with my jungle bonuses. And I went to, even though I did great on religion, I still didn't get the first pantheon. I went in there to try to pick my pantheon and it was gone. So I had to kind of readjust my thinking. The good thing is that Brazil gets great bonuses with great people, and that's sort of one of the things I like to play for. And there's a pantheon belief, Divine Spark, that works with great person generation. So that's what I went for. Okay, now as far as the other four beliefs go, the first thing you have to do is pick a follower belief. Mm-hmm. The reason for that is, if you think about the religion system, you don't want just the person who founded the religion to get all the benefits. You want, as he spreads it over other cities that the and other empires, that those people are going to be picking up benefits from it as well. So we insist that follower belief be part of the very first foundation of that religion. So there's mm-hmm. seven follower beliefs in the game. Tough choice. I haven't really thought about where I want to go with this one. But I always like work ethic. I feel like production is always good.
Yeah.
So I'm going to go with that one right now. And then for your second choice of a belief, you only get two out of the four beliefs from founding the religion. The second choice is wide open.
Yeah.
So you can choose anything. There are seven beliefs that are of a new type that we just introduced for Civ 6, and that's what we call the worship beliefs. Mm. And those are kind of what's your house of worship going to be like. Mm-hmm. So that's where the cathedral, the mosque, the pagoda, the wat, all these choices are considered a worship belief. I don't think we need to worry too much about that right now. There are a couple other beliefs that I really like to push for if I get an early religion. And my favorite happens to be missionary zeal, where religious units get to ignore movement costs of terrain.
Especially since we got some rainforest working for us.
Yeah, we have some difficult terrain right around us. And then the other thing about missionary zeal is, we haven't talked a lot about it. We'll see if we get to it today. I don't want to make any promises. Mm. But there is a new religious combat system.
Yeah,
missionary zeal is sort of like turbocharging all your religious units so they can, you know, get to the religious combat faster. And I've just found it to be very, very helpful. So that's a particular favorite of mine. I don't know if it's actually stronger than any of the other beliefs, but I feel like it just makes the religious game even more fun.
Yeah.
So I just like to take it for that reason.
Yeah, let's do it.
Okay. We got an inspiration. Inspirations are the boosts that you can get on the civics tree. And there's a theology civic, and you can get into the theology civic much faster if you actually have formed a religion.
Makes sense. Yeah.
So that's why we're getting that one. Yeah. And then we can see we have one city following the religion, which is Rio. We're going to have to go ahead and spread it to our other city.
Yeah. And our religion can actually support two more beliefs, which we will get to later. We sort of get to enhance and add based on whatever beliefs are left.
Right, and let me see if we have enough faith right away to buy a missionary, because then that can be used to get that religion over to the other civic. And it looks like we do not yet have enough
Probably
faith.
Probably need a shrine, yeah.
And that's right, we need a shrine, and I don't think, have I had time to build the shrine?
Let's check out the buildings. Yeah.
No, I don't have the shrine. The holy site.
It's a great holy site plus four, but yeah, no shrine yet. So that might be
okay. So and we are building a builder. Remember, I have that policy in place, so we can crank out builders faster right now. And in my second city, I'm trying to work on a second holy site.
Oh, man.
If you noticed, the second city is right next to Crater Lake.
Yeah.
So this is a second awesome holy site location. That's why I sort of I sent out via Twitter that we're playing the religion game here, and a lot of it's just based on my star position. It's not that Brazil is really the primo religion civs.
Yeah.
We're going to be talking about some religion civs later that are even stronger.
They're even better suited for
But with this particular start position, you know, religion is king, so I just went for it.
Yeah.
All right, so we're going to move forward. I'm hoping my spearmen won't get killed by a scout. That would be just darn embarrassing. Ooh, and the city-state.
Defending itself. Yeah, it's got some walls up, looks like.
Yeah, it did some damage with a range strike, so that's good. And we're on the next turn, and we finished the wheel tech, so that's good. And we have a unit that's ready to be promoted, and let's see who that is.
Is that spearmen? Yeah.
Excellent.
So that only gives them heals as well, which is nice.
Right. So the different things about promotions here is you have to end your turn when you promote.
Yeah.
You can't promote and then move. And I'm going to go ahead and slide him out of the way a little bit and then promote him. And we have a choice, bonus against cavalry units or bonus against melee units. I think that sort of depends what we think we're going to be hit from.
Right.
Barbarians can come in either a group of melee units or a group of cavalry units.
Yeah, it depends on where their camp spawns.
Right, if their camp spawns near a horse resource, we have just these really annoying cavalry barbarians. So I think
some
for that,
horses to the rest to the west of or to the east of Rio looks like, but looks like you explored there earlier. Was that one of the places where your scouts died? Was that
probably? I think you're right. Let's go ahead and take the. I took the one.
You took the melee, but it's okay because
this direction that's probably what we need.
And the spearman as well already has some bonus against mounted units.
Right. So this will kind of diversify him a little bit.
Exactly. So he's kind of more of like a Swiss Army knife.
Okay. So we don't need sailing. We have to make our tech choice here. We don't actually have any horse resources in our civ. So we have found that there's a bunch of iron to the north.
Some nice iron up there.
That might be our next next target. And we also, engineering is a consideration because we have unlocked the boost for it.
Mm-hmm.
The boost for that was to build ancient walls. And I was having so much trouble with barbarians
that
I was like,
we
need to wall up. I need to range strike.
Yeah.
So I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to look at my housing, and we're at 6 of 8 in housing.
We settled on a river, so we wouldn't need that aqueduct.
But our aqueduct would give us a couple extra points.
That's right. Yeah, that's right.
So I'm thinking that eventually we're going to run out of housing. That we have good. Yeah, in 3 turns we're going to get to 7 population, and then our housing is going to be slowing us down.
Start slowing down, People are going to be a little crowded.
Let's go engineering.
Cool.
All right, and now we have to continue to work on what we're doing against the barbarians here.
So is that the holy site that Manaus is building? The one that the barbarians were just like...
Yeah, just like running right over
wrecking.
While we were trying to build it.
Yeah.
We're going to have to... I'm a little worried about this scout. He's obviously coming from a camp over there somewhere, and I
might be a horse
don't
camp.
Know. It's we don't have any previously revealed camp, so it might be one that spawned recently. So that's sort of a wild card. So let's get our scout to at least follow him. And actually, for that reason, I'm going to pull this warrior back towards our capital. Okay, Stonehenge has been constructed by another player, so that means somebody else has a religion now.
Mm,
so we're gonna have a little bit of competition in the Wonder Game.
Yeah, you got an early rush for religion by being Brazil and getting that awesome holy site, but someone else can rush religion easily.
That's the other way to do it, is to get Stonehenge. and we got a gossip report that came up at about the same time, and I'm curious, let's talk a little bit about the other leaders that we've met.
Yeah.
And what's going on
with them. What's the situation here?
So, if you look at the mini-map, that's probably the easiest way to see where the other civs are. They're spaced nice and evenly around us, so nobody's like the close threat.
Mm-hmm.
But we have Japan, Down here, we've got France, and we have England. Mm-hmm. And they all have either as much population in their capital as we do or more. So they're off to very fine starts.
And one of them stole Sacred Path from, well, that could be someone else.
I'm not sure who stole Sacred Path. That's something that's interesting. You only find that out if you have met that civ, so you have a gossip channel with them when they found the Pantheon.
Get some visibility, right?
And I didn't have that yet, so I don't actually know who has that. So let's look at each of them. Catherine, we have a neutral relationship with. I have gone ahead and I've sent out delegations to each of these leaders.
That's a good way
to give us the limited gossip access level.
Yeah.
So that means that if there are any diplomatic modifiers affecting our relationship, I'll see those. With Catherine, we're sort of like entirely neutral at the moment. But with the other two people, they're both unfriendly with us. So let's see if we can figure out why. So Hojo of Japan and Victoria. With this cutoff UI, it's really hard to see what the reasons are.
Oh, there we go.
But they're down here.
Yeah.
So she's unhappy because she wants to expand to a continent that we occupy.
Yeah, so actually we are technically on different continents.
Right, and I think that's something that we probably need to explain because it's pretty confusing for previous players of Civilization because a continent has always been the same as a landmass in Civilization.
Yeah, but even in real history that's not true. Like, there's a lot of different ways you can slice geography, and like North America and South America are, you know, two continents in one way, but one big landmass in another way. So, you know, we definitely play with what the idea of a continent is.
Right. So what we do when we do map generation is we look at how many civs are in the game, and the rough rule of thumb is we should have a continent for every two civs in the game. Mm-hmm. This is a game with, I think, it looks like we have 8 civs in this game.
Yeah.
So we're going to have 4 continents.
Yeah.
But we chose the Pangaea map script. So that is going to put everything in one landmass, but then what the game system will do is they'll divide them up into 4 continents. Mm. And we have one of our lenses that will show you color-coded but what continent it is. The other thing you can do is you can just mouse over a tile and get the tooltips for the tile. Okay. So here we're on the continent.
Oh, it's the lost continent of Mu.
Yes, we found it right where Brazil started here.
Churchward would be
better. And we can go look up where London is and find out that London is on the continent called Pangaea. So they are definitely on a different continent, and so that's why Victoria's a little snarky with us, is she's feeling like she wants to have a city on every continent. That's what her Sun Never Sets agenda does.
Yeah.
And so she's looking in our direction for that.
Oh, Ed, someone in the chat wants to know if we would like a trade agreement with England. Is that is that something we want to make set up?
Yeah, well, you know, trade agreements with England have gotten a lot of press in the Civ community, so maybe we should consider that. And actually, that is a good way to kind of turn around the unhappy.
That's true. We start trading.
We could just send her gold. We could actually just set up a trade route. I do have one trade route set up right now. It's running between our two cities.
Yeah.
Where else to place cities?
Might not be showing up on this build. Yeah.
There's that evidence. UI, I think, was just being put in the game when we put this build in.
But I noticed the road there. That's how your archer was able to kind of
right.
book it down to Manaus there earlier.
Yeah. So let's go ahead and let's get the shrine going.
Sounds
good. We want to keep pushing the religion game.
Yeah, we're making good faith outcome too, especially once we get that second holy site going on.
And I'm going to push our spearmen down, and let's go ahead and take a shot at that barbarian scout across Crater Lake.
Yeah.
And he survived, but he's in
the
trouble.
The city-state might finish him off, yeah.
Okay, and so our builder. Okay, first thing we have to do is, before we were playing, I had my banana plantation totally ravaged by the barbarians, so we have to repair that. Here's that scout I'm worried has a camp nearby. Let's pop up onto the hill
and look east
and see if there's anything that way. It doesn't look like it, so I'll just hold off there. And I think that's it for now.
So. Someone in the chat's asking if a worship belief is required. Those are the ones that unlock the buildings. Actually, one of the interesting things about the religion system is you can sort of choose the order after your follower belief. You sort of choose what's important to you.
Right.
So you can, you know, you can decide like, hey, I really want this building. I'm gonna lock this down now when I found the religion. Or you can take a risk and kind of save that for later.
Right. So we're going to pull in our worship belief a little bit later. But eventually we'll have to get one if we're going to fully configure a religion.
Yeah.
Okay, we do have a deal here. This is an offer from Japan, not with England. But we could have a trade agreement with Hojo to at least have open borders. I'm not sure. I'll just stay on friendly terms. It does make them friendlier to have open borders with it. So
yeah.
We'll go ahead and choose it for that reason. Okay.
Oh, they're trading with Egypt. Okay.
So yep, we got some gossip that... Japan's trading with, and oh my goodness.
Oh, this is bad.
We just got a bunch of barbarians coming in from the north. We hadn't even been looking that way.
In two turns, I'm going to have this situation to deal with. This is not
yeah.
fair.
Well, I did send this warrior back, but pretty much your whole army's out of position right now.
Oh, no.
So, yeah, that's not really good. And our poor...
Well, we're about to repair the bananas, but they might be in
trouble
again.
Let's repair, and then... He can't capture us because we have the river and the jungle in between.
There's enough movement barriers
for
this
turn. Yeah, so
the
movement barriers will save us this time. But...
Yeah, and we have ancient roads, so we don't have that bridge yet getting us over to the rice farm.
I'll go this way. And I think it's time to take our very good archer and get him home. Where do we think the camp is right now? I'm gonna go east and see if we see anything this way.
You got a couple of people asking if repair eats up a worker charge. It actually does not.
Right.
That's something
but
we experimented
it does,
with.
It does end his turn.
It does.
Yeah, we had thought about it using up a charge, but it's a little tough. You get enough pillaging going on. Pillaging is very cool in this game because every different type of improvement and every different type of district can give you a different yield. So if you pillage a campus, for instance, you actually can earn science out of that. So
you steal all their books.
Yeah, exactly. pillaging is very fruitful in this game, but that tends to mean it happens a fair amount. We decided we didn't want the builders to take a whole charge just to do a repair.
Yeah, because you can get yourself into a hole under like a city siege and stuff if you're being raided, you know, constantly, where you kind of keep having to, you'd have to keep building builders again just to keep your city online. So, yeah.
Okay, we got a notification that our second city, Manaus, needs housing. Manaus is actually a really interesting city in Brazil.
Yeah.
One thing also to point out here is Manaus is not like the second biggest city in Brazil. It's not the second city that was founded in Brazilian history. It's kind of weird that right after Rio, we got Manaus as our second city.
Yeah.
And the reason for that is that Civ 6 does not have a deterministic list on how the cities are unveiled for you. We start by always giving you the same capital every time. But after that, it's sort of a random die roll between the next 10 cities.
Mm-hmm.
And we just happened to get Manaus. I think it's like fifth or sixth on the city list.
Right.
But the cool thing about that is like when you go up to another civ and you notice, hey, this is America, and you see, you know, New York or Boston, which was typically second or third in the city list, you don't know that that's the second or third city anymore.
Yeah.
It's not that predictable. And I sort of like Manaus. Manaus is this really weird city in the middle of the Amazon rainforest that you can't get to by road because it would be just so obnoxious to build a road there. So
ours is better. We can get to ours by road.
We can get to ours by road. But in the real Manaus, you have to like fly in there or take a boat in there.
Wow.
So it also was really interesting when they tried to host the World Cup there because it was so humid there that they actually had to take breaks in the middle of the soccer game.
Mm.
It was the first World Cup game ever to have a water break in the middle of every half.
Yeah, that seems unusual.
Because it was so hot there. So anyways, I was really happy to see Manaus come up.
That's cool, yeah.
All right, so I've got one more turn here before I turn it over to Anton, and I'm in trouble, but luckily I built some walls, so I can do some city range strikes here, and we will bomb away at the first incoming warrior. We have scout who's pressing after the camp. And then I'm going to hide my boulder under the walls.
Oh man, our stone quarry there is pillaged too.
Yeah. Yeah, you're not being left with a really good situation. Okay. I am turning it over to Anton.
All right. So I'm going to hand over the Twitch chat to Ed. So if you guys got questions, we're trying to look occasionally and answer stuff that you guys want to know more about. So now the games and recreation are complete. So this lets us get access to the Coliseum, another economic policy. It would give us the entertainment complex, but as Brazil, we have the street carnival unique district. And what this does, if we have it in one of our cities, is we get to put on, if we can contribute production to a city project called the Carnival. While the carnival's going on, our city gets more amenities, these people are more happy and productive, and when the carnival is done, we get a lot of great people points. So it feeds into that great people strategy that Brazil is very good at. We also get the arena, which is the first building that goes into the street carnival. So we can take another look at the policies we have here. I'm glad that we had put in that discipline policy earlier on, because it's certainly going to be useful right now. So I think I'm going to keep that one in there. So unfortunately, our classical republic is not in its best light right now.
I think you can probably get rid of the builder policy, because we actually sort of need two military policies.
We kind of do. This would have been a great time to have.
You can switch governments.
I could. Is it worth? Yeah.
Because we get two military policies if you go autocracy.
You could get
both the production of military units and the, I don't know, it's an interesting decision.
What is, it's a succession game after all, I think it's fitting. So the Anton autocracy is now in effect. So we got two military policies, we're going to have some discipline. Recon units, our scouts are kind of like at home right now. We could reduce our gold maintenance, which is nice. We could train more military units.
I think the training one might be really good.
Yeah, so melee and range units, let's do some of that. So we don't get a diplomatic policy as an autocracy. You know, we prefer to bash people instead of, you know, working on city-state relationships and stuff like that. I'm also going to take out the reduced plot costs.
Right.
I think we have other priorities right now. So for our economic choice, we get some more housing in cities, but we don't have a whole lot
we
of
don't
districts
have any cities
online
for two yet. Districts. You
could
think of urban planning.
Yeah, urban planning is good, and it gives some production to our second city
right.
in the rainforest there. So yeah, let's give that one a shot. As for wildcard policies, I don't know. I'm not really tempted by the diplomatic ones, but maybe we could start working towards a great scientist.
Yeah, or a great general.
Yeah, a great general could be good, too.
Now, we don't have either of the districts that support those, so we're sort of not really pushing the point. I guess it sort of depends what we're going to build next. If we're going to go encampment, we should go great general. If we're going to go campus, go great scientist. But I'm going to leave that decision to you.
Mm. Well, for now, being an autocracy, let's check out the great general place. Let's go do that. Policy agenda is set. Okay, so the scout here, I kind of want to see, uh-oh. Look what we got here.
Oh, my goodness. All right, we have a question here in the chat from Polovic, who says, the UI seems really big. Is there an option to change the size? And we explained that right at the very beginning of the chat, that we're playing with only 720 resolution because of the live screen resolution.
Right.
So the UI will slides out to the side, and the bigger and bigger TV or whatever monitor you have, it kind of
it's
falls away nicely. So,
yeah.
Yes, it's going to look real cramped here right now today because of the way we're live streaming it, but this is actually, I think, below the minimum spec that we have recommended for real estate.
It is.
For screen resolution.
Right.
So it pretty much never looks this cramped.
Okay, I'll send our scout to go here. So this is a barbarian horse archer. That's trouble. If our spearman were up here, he'd be a great counter. But he's down exploring here, so he might have to do something else.
Yeah.
So we do have actually range strike.
I would also consider, we have enough gold, we might want to just buy a unit.
Okay. Yeah, let's see.
May be problematic enough
that
it's time to buy a unit.
Can we get, Archer 130? Yeah. Let's do it.
Yep.
Okay, so we'll have an Archer ready next turn in case, that's when they'll probably be in range. Our builder probably has to stick around. We could maybe send him down
Don't think I built that city on a hill, so he's not going to be able to shoot over the trees. So we'll have to move him out.
you might have to risk being in the jungle here.
Yeah.
But our warrior will come to back him up, so that'll be good. I'm going to keep the builder here for now. Deal with this crisis first. All right, so we got our next civics choice. Let's see what we're working with. So we got political philosophy. That's a really key civic that will give us those three government choices. We work towards drama and poetry, start getting our culture going. That gives us some good policies to choose from. But in the continuing theme of the military focus, tempted by some of these military ones up here. So we can get better pillaging with the raid policy, encampment district, buildings for that district. This might be good, because if we start, we have the great general policy, and then if we start working towards an encampment to actually kind of work towards that, this will be a nice synergy.
Yeah, it wasn't where I was planning to go, but we're having enough trouble with barbarians, it may be where we need to go.
Yeah, and if you don't like it in five turns, we can change it. So 55 is when I'm handing back the reins.
Okay, there's a good question here in the chat from Mythdracon. How come government choices don't launch you into anarchy?
Oh, well.
And they can launch you into anarchy. We don't ever really want to encourage players to swap back and forth min-maxing governments so that you're like trying to like, okay, I need this government for five turns, and I'm going to go back to this one for five turns, and I'm going to go back to this other one for five turns. Mm-hmm. So what we do is anytime you're returning to a government that you've been in before, your people look at that as just like going backwards, and that there's anarchy if that occurs. But anytime you go into a government for the very first time, it's like a smooth transition. So that's one of those things. Maybe we'll adjust it based on some more of the balance testing we're doing, but at the moment we kind of like that system. It gives you a chance to try out every government once, but once you leave one, you have to kind of realize that going back there is going to be tough.
So what you're saying is, now that I've switched to autocracy, going back to classical republic is going to be really hard.
The way is forward. And that may, all troops, may, we all may the regret time. That, because as Brazil, we want a great person generation system up and running, and now going back to classical republic is going to incur some pain and suffering.
Yeah, so I may have taken us down a certain path there, but we'll adapt as the time comes. So we can actually start building our street carnival district now, which would be pretty cool. Watermill is also a really nice choice right now because, in addition to giving us some food and production to make the city even better.
I always forget what policy I have, and I think we locked in that policy that cranks up melee units right now.
We did, didn't we? We should take advantage of that.
So, yes. So don't sleep on that. I always get distracted by the economic choices, too.
I do, too. I like making the buildings.
But I think we need to go spearmen or...
Let's get a spearman, because, we have one down there, but it'd be nice to have a second one in case this horse archer causes problems. So, yeah, and... Actually, I think our shrine is done now, as is our engineering research. So we could actually start making a missionary and start spreading our religion.
Yes, we should do that.
Sneak down the river here. Oh, no!
Barbarian, he's at least a damaged horseman.
He is. Hopefully we won't be too bad. All right, so let's shoot some arrows here. Try to take down the biggest threats first. Yeah, that's fine. Our spearmen. Let's send our spearmen down here a little bit. Okay, that went pretty well. It's probably not worth... Yeah, because then he'll have the horse archer. Yeah, I'm just going to actually save and promote this unit. So, +7 when attacking melee and ranged units, or +10 when defending against ranged attacks. Battle cry is usually one of my favorites, but in this situation, Tortoise is actually
pretty
great.
You got that horse
archer.
Yeah,
so I think I'm going to do that.
Yep.
And, like you were mentioning earlier, promotion in Civ 6 kind of combines the insta-heal and picking a perk that Civ 5 had when you promote a unit, but it ends your turn. Oh, there we go. Okay, so let's finish this guy off.
Okay, and we have a couple people in the chat who've been asking about Sean Bean. They've been hearing his voice on the tech quotes.
Yes.
But in this build, they're not hearing it on the civic quotes.
Mm.
And I think we can go ahead and tell everybody he's going to be doing both.
Yes.
We just didn't have the audio for all of that ready for this build.
Yes, we made some unfortunate coworker read all of the placeholder lines while we were waiting on the Sean Bean recordings.
He's probably being hideously embarrassed by the fact that we're live streaming his versions of the civic quotes.
Yes.
But
apologies.
Oh, well.
All right, so we finished our engineering. So actually, we could do an aqueduct eventually. So I'm trying to figure out our next tech choice here. We could do horseback riding, ironworking. ironworking, like we have iron nearby, but we're not going to be able to really take advantage of it for a while to get the
sword. We probably need another city first.
We do. So horseback riding, be nice if we were going on the offensive. Mathematics is probably like a pretty good general choice, though. We got the sailing stuff up here, but we're not really near the water, so I think I'm going to choose mathematics. And I don't think we'll get the boost for that in time, because we're actually doubling up on holy sites. We're not going to get the...
Right, and that's one of the downsides of overemphasizing one district, is there are several boosts that are tied to having a diversity of districts.
Right.
And you lose out on those if you're trying to, like, cram all districts in one type. Now, one thing to notice, let's go up to the districts. The Street Carnival is the unique district for Brazil, and you can notice that it's only takes half as much time to build.
That's right.
One of the things that we've done with unique districts for civilizations is if it's your unique district, it basically has half the production costs of other districts. So it's sort of, it's something you specialize in, something you're good at, so it doesn't take you much time to put it on. I'm not recommending it right now necessarily, but...
But it has a carnival.
Yeah, I know. And that's cool. And it's Brazil week here, so maybe we should build it.
I think I'm going to follow your advice from earlier, though, and actually use this opportunity to build up our army a little bit. And then once our military training is done, we can swap back out and maybe use the military policy that reduces our maintenance costs, because this army would get expensive after a while. So we can do, actually get another, I'm gonna do another warrior.
Yeah.
Pretty quick with that policy.
And don't forget to buy your missionary, unless you're, have you already done that?
Nah, not yet. I think we got enough now, yeah. So I'll do that next turn. Okay, let's keep exploring over here. Let's do that before I forget. Alright, so we'll open up this. Alright.
We have to move the builder out.
That's right, yeah.
But that's
everybody's
a good
in a traffic jam because
that's
we're
a good
attack.
Move anyways.
Yeah, so let's see.
He can pick one of our smoking improvements to go.
Oh, that was a mistake there. Let's get the spearman out of the way. Alright. Same class in this location. Yeah, it might have. Oh no. Yeah, the builder is still there. You're right. Okay, so yeah, let's just get the builder out of the way for now. Hope nobody comes and flanks us. We can go down here. Okay, there's that guy.
But he's our guy with the tortoise promotion, right?
It is. So he'll be a good vanguard for us. There we go. Let's get a missionary. All right. So this is our holy city. For Catholicism, is already Catholic. They are good followers of our prophet Confucius.
Right, the Catholic prophet Confucius.
Yeah, so here we got our missionary. I'm probably not going to send him out yet because we just purchased him, so he can't move anyway. But when I select him, I see the religion lens, which sort of gives me a nice way to look around the map and see kind of how things are going for the religion game. So we have a little bit of pressure already coming out from our holy city here, and our holy city has a majority of Catholic folks here. But yeah, there's a couple nearby cities that are seeing the pressure from this holy site. Further out, these city-states aren't being affected yet. So I don't know, there's a couple different ways we could go here. We could lock down our religion and start spreading it in Manaus, speed that up, or we could try to like send it a little further away and get another node on the sort of graph of the religious game and get kind of
does
spread.
Any of the city states have the spread the religion to me quest?
Let's see. We got trained horsemen. Got construct campus. Send a trade route. That might be a good one to do later.
And
recruit grain scientists.
Doesn't that make sense for Geneva since they're a scientific city state?
Indeed. Yeah, so it seems like nobody's particularly won Catholicism yet, but we'll probably give it to them anyway. It'll just be a matter of
maybe that's a good argument to send it to Manaus first then.
All right, let's do it.
Although there is a barbarian right in the way, so he might need escorting.
Yeah, we can do a formation when he's able to move next turn. All right, so yeah, let's get... I think I'm actually going to get a trader going. Maybe our trader got plundered by the barbarians.
I
think that's what happened.
That is what happened. Well, that's good. Maybe we can send the trade route to Lisbon or whichever city-state wanted a trade route.
Yeah, I think it was Lisbon, the trade city-state, which makes sense. Yeah. So who else we got to move here? Okay, so there's a spearman, found another camp down here. Looks like he might be alone. So he got two more turns before passing my newly minted autocracy over to the... to confuse Ed. with what I've left in his wake. At least I've kind of cleared out some of this barbarian problem, though. Oh, man. Yeah, there's definitely a horse camp nearby somewhere. I'm just going to flee into the forest. Oh, you got the forest promotion, didn't you?
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah, so that guy...
That's perfect for Brazil.
Yep, can move through rainforest or woods at one movement point each.
Okay, let's smack this guy in the face. All right.
Nice.
Yeah, so I think he's going to go toe-to-toe with this guy pretty well, but I didn't see the horseman there, so I'm going to send the spearman for backup.
Yep.
Just
take that scout out between your archers
take some
and
shots.
The marine strike.
Yeah, I think we can get him. Get our city folks there. Loose some
arrows. And now there's a clear path for the missionary. You might even be able to send them without escorting them.
Yeah. I think we're actually pretty safe, so let's go ahead and move down there. All right. Someone else. Finished your warrior. Excellent. So we're working on our trader up here, right?
Okay, here's an interesting... religion question from Mr. Who 995. He's wondering if the pantheons become progressively more expensive as more are founded, like in Civ 5. And we actually dropped that. There are a lot of very specific Civ 5 type of mechanics like that that we sort of rethought.
Right.
Pantheons had changes like that where everyone gets them at the same point. Especially since you get to keep your pantheon now, we wanted to sort of make it so that if you pushed faith really early, and there is a policy that helps you do that, the God King policy, even if you don't have another source of it around,
yeah,
that you could lock in that pantheon and keep it for your civ going forward.
Right. Cool. So it looks like before ending the turn here, we actually earned an envoy. And I think this one was actually from our government. So each government will give us influence points, and as those build up, we will get envoys to send to city-states. And we can also get envoys from researching certain civics, like actually military training will give us one once it's done. And we can also get them by fulfilling these quests directly. But yeah, so we can take a look here at who we want to send an envoy to.
It's a great time to go through the unique bonuses of each of these city-states. We actually have four different types here, so that worked out nicely.
Yeah, so let's take a look. So Preslav here, their suzerain bonus. So they're a militaristic city-state. And the militaristic type bonuses, which they all share, are +2 production specifically towards producing units. And the first tier is for the capital.
Definitely helping us right now.
Yeah, definitely. And then the later tiers will help encampments. So this would be a great choice for the Anton autocracy. there is suzerain bonus if we happen to maintain being their ally throughout the game. Our light and heavy cavalry units have additional combat strength when fighting on hill tiles. So. It's pretty cool. I don't think it suits our terrain because we're kind of like in jungle land here. So that wouldn't be my first choice, but let's take a look at the others here. So Nanmadol is our sort of friendly neighbor here who's helping us with the barbarians. They're a cultural city-state, and they grants +2 culture to districts on or next to coast tiles, which is pretty interesting. We do have some lakes going on here, but the ocean's pretty far away on a Pangaea map, so that also probably would not be my first pick.
And actually, the holy sites, neither of them are next to the... I think lakes do count as coasts, but neither of our holy sites districts that we've put in place so far are next to them.
Yeah, because we wanted them in the jungle.
Right. We love everything in the jungle. We got to totally embrace this Brazil mindset here.
Yeah. Geneva might actually be a good pick. So they, if we're their suzerain, give +15% science to our entire civilization, which is very powerful, but... They're a peace-loving city-state. If we are going around having war with people, even if other people are having war with us, that bonus is not going to kick in. So if we're planning on playing a peaceful game, maybe getting some diplomatic visibility, making sure we're not pissing people off, we're just kind of like going for a nice culture victory or something like that, this would be a great choice.
Interestingly enough, you have enough that you can become suzerain of Nan Mandel, I think, but not of the other ones.
Yeah, so we have one envoy to work with. As the game continues and you get more advanced governments, we get more envoys at a time.
And my favorite thing that we've added with the city-state system is the ability to levy their military and take control of them.
Yes.
So if the barbarians were attacking from our southwest through Nan Mandel right now, I would totally be saying, slap that envoy on Nan Mandel, let's levy their military, and let's just take care of our barbarian problem.
Yeah.
With their assistance.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, they're sort of exactly in the wrong direction, so I'm not sure that move makes sense right now.
A little bit. And yeah, I think this barbarian problem is mostly cleared out. Let's take a look at Lisbon. This is actually one of my favorite suzerain bonuses. Trader units are immune to being plundered on water tiles. So this is great, especially for water-based maps. Again, on Pangaea, not maybe my first pick.
Right.
But yeah, so like normally boats, you know, trading when going over water would be very vulnerable to barbarians and stuff like that, anybody you're at war with. But
we need the land version of Lisbon since our land trader got plundered, but
yes,
alas. Didn't have that. Yes.
Yeah, so I don't know. I think I'm gonna pick Geneva.
Okay. That seems like a good long term pick.
Yeah. All right, so our archer, actually I probably should have moved him over to the front here, but that's okay. Who else needs orders?
And one thing we wanted to mention is we do have a special video that we've got queued up to play at right at the end of the live stream today when we hit the hour point. So hopefully everyone can stick with us that long to catch that when we get to it. And we're getting pretty close to it right now.
Mm-hmm. Let's see if he's going to make a move. All right, next turn. I believe I'm passing it over to you.
All right. Oh, and here come the barbarian horsemen.
It'll be fine.
Yeah. Well, we survived. I'm not sure about fine, but
okay. I should have sent my archers over there. I was too distracted.
All right, so my first move, just to show how it works, is let's select our missionary. Notice when we select a missionary, that religion lens that you're showing off automatically kicks in.
Yeah.
So he can come down towards our next city, and we can spread religion there.
Ta-da.
And then our builder needs to get over to our quarry so he can do some damage repair there. And I may need to pull this guy back. So let's hide him in the jungle and move forward with our spearman.
That's a good
move.
Go
ahead and make an attack right
there. Yes. Aren't you glad someone left a spearman there for you?
Yeah, well, I did suggest purchasing him, so
that's
I'll
true.
Take at least a little bit of the credit for that one. Okay, and I'm not sure. You found a camp. Oh, it's all the way down here.
Yeah, it's kind of far. I don't know if it's
but
that much
of
a threat.
Let's attack him with this guy. And I'll send him as reinforcements. Okay. Okay, now none of these technologies or civics are going to complete in the five turns I'm running our autocracy, but hopefully I can at least deal with the barbarian problem. The Amandel has built a heavy chariot. Look at that. Look at it. And it looks like we have the barbarians on the run. At
nice.
Last, we're starting to exert our dominance over them.
You're welcome.
So we could spend some money to make a policy change here since we're not like desperate for producing military units right now.
Right.
But we do have some good policies in place, like the one that's plus one production in both our cities. And I think I'm okay with not having to pay for the government change. Now, here's our first chance to look at the trade route interface. And when a trader's selected, we get a list of all the possible cities he can go to and what the yields we'll get out of the different choices are.
Mm-hmm.
And if I remember right, it was Lisbon that had the quest to send a trade route there. And as a nice economic city state, we'd get 5 gold out of it, which is
not bad.
Is certainly strong.
That's so more things for the Spearman Fund.
Yeah, we're going to go ahead and do that. Now the missionaries come up as our active unit, and you can see the religion lens has popped up. And Manaus, that city is draped in our religion color, so we know that we did convert it successfully.
We're also seeing the massive faith that we're getting from our holy sites there.
Right, plus 6 from each. So I think we keep the religion train rolling and head it over to Nan Mandel.
Spread the good word.
And because we picked that missionary zeal.
The zeal is awesome.
Our missionary is just flying through the rainforest. And we can go ahead and spread religion there. Now, he only has 2 charges.
Mm.
So we're going to have to buy another missionary.
And we've got some good faith stored up.
Yeah, so I'm going to go ahead and queue another one up and get him going so we can keep pushing the religion game here. Okay, and you notice that missionary costs 55 faith. That's a little subtle change that we have, but a lot of our units, they sort of scale up in cost based on how many of them you've purchased in the game.
Right.
That's one of the ways that we control how many settlers you build in the game is each one gets more expensive over the previous one. So that's why this missionary costs a little bit more. Now, how are we doing on time here? I think we're getting pretty close to, okay, we got enough time. I might be able to get through my turns before the end of the live stream if I push it here. We did get credit for the city-state quest. And let's go ahead and... we're building the shrine down in Manaus. I think we want to get the street carnival going. At least we want to at least consider possible locations for it. Now, this is something that you want to sort of build between your cities because eventually it'll have a regional effect.
Right.
So I kind of like this spot down here, right on the road between the two cities.
And then Manaus will be able to benefit later in the game.
Right. So we'll go ahead and get our entertainment district going. Right now it's just a pile of sticks and stuff that have to be put together, but we'll get there eventually. And reinforcements against the barbarian camp. Oh, we found a giddy hut that we never popped. That may have been found before, but right as one of my scouts died, I kind of forgot about it from when I played the game before till today.
And thankfully, the barbarians in the city states aren't going to be able to nab those up. They're not cool enough for the tribal villages to pay attention to. But us as a big civilization, we get some nice
bonuses. We're going to repair our quarry. We're going to keep pushing out with our scout. Okay, now this is a chance to talk about the hidden agendas. Victoria normally has the agenda that she wants to get a city on every continent. And we know that she's unhappy about us living on a different continent from hers.
Yeah.
But it appears that we have satisfied her other hidden agenda for caring really about how populous each of the empires is. And so because we have so many people, and we got that second city up, and both our cities are doing real well on food. So they've both been growing. We were careful about our housing so they could keep growing.
Right.
So we actually got a kudos for her for doing a good job on that. And so once that's triggered, the unfriendly status with her will start to go away over time. We should be able to rebuild our diplomatic relationship with her.
Yeah, and those delegations you sent early on have some positive favor working for us as well.
But we'll have to keep an eye on it. She looks at the population of all the players in the game, and if we start lagging behind, she'll notice that, and all of a sudden she won't be happy about her population.
So what you're saying is the Antonotocracy needs to go and like make sure that other people don't have population.
We could do that with some of our spearmen or something, I think, probably very easily. All right. So, got another missionary. Nan Mandel has not quite converted, so we'll send him there first.
Yeah, looks like 3 out of 6.
And we're going to go ahead and just keep deploying outward with our units just to make sure we're protecting ourselves much better than we were before.
Yeah, maybe secure that iron up top for some swordsmen.
Here's a new luxury resource, mercury, and that has just come within our culture boundary, so we can go ahead and improve that. That's going to help our amenity situation, which is nice. And we can pop this goody hut, some extra faith for a new missionary. And let me see if I can finish off this barbarian camp and maybe get the gold for that.
Oh, so close.
Not quite this turn. Okay, so before we go next turn, I just got the word that it's 5 o'clock and we've hit our hour time limit, which I'm kind of bummed about because I wanted to turn it back over to you again. But let's go ahead and play the special video reveal that we had queued up for the end of the live stream here.
Down
so we're going to take a look at one of our new wonders.
People have managed to silence the Marikana, the Pope, Frank Sinatra.
This is the build animation. And we're super excited to have this as one of our new wonders. It's the Estadio do Marikana. My Spanish probably not the best there, but took a shot at it. And not only did it host the World Cup when it was held in Brazil, but it also is going to be huge in just a couple days because we have the Olympics coming into play. I'm a huge fan of the Olympics. I've always kind of loved the spectacle of it, and it's sort of like a little mini Civ game to me because you get all the nations lined up and they're duking it out. I love watching the opening ceremonies because it's sort of, to me, it's a little bit like that country's statement on why they should win the culture victory in a Civ game. So I'll definitely be tuned in later this week, and we just think it's really cool to be able to take that stadium and have it as a new World Wonder. We want to make sure that our World Wonders are from all the different continents, and this was a way to get another one onto South America. So we're really excited to be showing that. It is a late game wonder that unlocks through the Civic system.
Right.
And we won't go into too much detail on what its bonuses are because all those late game wonders we're going to be talking about later, but we can tell you it's definitely very, very useful.
Yeah.
So now that we've been talking about soccer or football, we have to ask our producers, are we out of time here or can we go a little bit longer? I'm hoping for some stoppage time here, guys.
Do we get any injury time for
Barbarian? Oh, yeah. Yes. All right. Cool. We have stoppage time. So into stoppage time, I'm going to plow through my next few turns and hand it back over to Anton here. Okay, who needs orders? Or a scout.
He's making it pretty far there, yeah.
Okay. And the same open deal.
Oh,
Victoria must be happier with us.
Do we want a trade agreement with England?
Yeah, it is a trade agreement with England, isn't it?
It finally happens.
Gotta do it. Yeah. She wants a trade agreement. We have to do it. She thinks it'll benefit us. The Civ community knows a trade agreement with England's helpful, so there we go. That wasn't even scripted, was it? Funny how these things happen. So next turn, keep exploring. Keep pushing out our boundaries. And we have two build charges left with this builder. There's deer nearby that's not improved.
How about that cocoa?
Oh, cocoa in the... Yes, that's going to help our amenity situation.
Chocolate.
And we are down to amenities in Rio, and they are craving chocolate.
So we can't put on a carnival for them quite yet, so chocolate will have to do.
Right. And this looks like a little risky attack because our guy is so low.
But oh, yes.
Yeah, they're even lower, so we conquer it. There's some extra gold for you to spend here.
Yes.
We have to look at the housing situation in Manaus. Ooh, look, see, notice how it's 50 turns until it grows population.
Yeah.
We probably have just totally neglected
our
housing.
4 out of 5, yeah, so we're running a little low.
Okay, so a couple things we can do. We can, the cocoa will build some plantations.
Right,
the plantations give you half a point of housing, so that'll be a start, and I just found another barbarian camp for you.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's not necessarily a plus, but it's there. Oh, we can also build a granary in Manaus.
Give us that too.
That gives us two housing, so that's an obvious move.
Yeah.
And Nan Mandel has converted now.
Excellent.
So we will send our guy Preslav away. And he's just going to hang on and retreat next turn. And let's bomb this.
Oh, you gotta heal.
Yeah.
Just find a nice little dune.
All right, it's back over to the Antonocracy.
All right. Hang on, scout dog. Bark. Yeah, we're fine. It's fine.
Those who in quarrels interpose.
Okay. Hey, cool.
So
we actually got that technology boost, probably because of our carnival just finished. So we got that boost that actually finished the mathematics research that we were working on. We also have military training. Very cool. So this might be a good time to slot this in and start working on an encampment. We're not really going on the offensive right now, so this raiding thing
can be waiting for later.
Let's see.
The advice of Plato and
Let's stick with autocracy for now. Switching back to classical republic would cause some anarchy. We don't want that right now. So I think now that the barbarians are a little more under control, you can swap in this unit maintenance one, which is really nice. So that'll, like, the cost of our standing army will go down, especially since these are ancient and classical era units. Their gold maintenance isn't that high, so reducing it by one actually cuts the cost really significantly.
Did you start an encampment district?
Not yet, no.
We do have the policy there that's unlocked for that if we want to.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, and we can maybe risk not doing the barbarian thing just now. So, encampment. Perfect. Urban planning, I think we'll keep. Great general, we can keep. Yeah, I think that's good for now. Let's double check and see what great general we can work towards. So we're actually, with that policy, we're now halfway towards earning a great general, Mr. Hannibal Barca, one of my favorite figures from history. And he will give combat strength to classical and medieval land units within two tiles. He'll also now give plus one movement, but that text isn't in this bill. And then when he retires, like when his when the classical and medieval land units are kind of, you know, past the game and he's sort of past his prime, he can retire and that will give a free promotion to a military land unit that's in his tile. So if we had a bunch of gold or a bunch of faith, we could rush him if we really wanted to make sure that we got them. But in that case, I think in this case we're good. So we'll just wait on that to happen. This scout needs to get away. Get far away. All right. Because this is not great. I don't think you're going to be able to shoot, but let's do this. Back you up. Yeah, I can't shoot over the hills, that's fine. I'll skip a turn for now. Let's diversify a little bit, get some culture. I'll pick some drama and poetry.
Yep. There's kind of those two key indicators up on the top bar in the upper corner, the 13.8 for the science and the 9.3 for the culture. If you're sort of running a balanced rate between the two trees, those numbers usually equal out, so we can tell we're getting a little behind in culture.
Yeah.
Now, we haven't built a campus yet either, so...
That's true.
Neither we're really strong in faith right now, but we're a little bit behind in both.
Okay, so I'm gonna do that plantation. Perfect. Okay, Rio. So now that we have finished our carnival district here.
Yeah, let's look at what bonuses we can get for certain districts by jungle adjacency.
Yeah, so if I remember correctly, the theater district, the theater square, once we get that, we'll be have some bonuses.
The campus and the commercial district do as well.
Yeah, the campus does for every player. So definitely, that's like, true. There's a lot of, actually, this is a really good spot, kind of nestled between the two mountains here.
And this is something we haven't talked about, but bonus resources like stone can actually be harvested.
Yeah.
By your builder, it's sort of like doing a woods chop in previous games. So just because that stone's there, it doesn't block us from building a district on that. We could go send the builder out, harvest the stone. That will give us a big short time production boost.
Yeah.
And then stick a just wonderful plus four campus in there.
Yeah. We could do that. We also, since we're placing a district now, we have the option to, if we buy this tile, which I'm going to do anyway, let's buy the tile. We could place a district here and it will remove the stone, but because we're doing it by the city production, we don't have a builder on the site, we're not going to get that production bonus.
Right.
If we send the builder, we have to spend a charge, but we get a production bonus for our city, so it's kind of a trade-off.
We don't have a builder anywhere nearby?
I thought we did, so I think that's probably the better play here. We had the, he's down here making plantations, but he does have one build left.
We could buy a builder in the city with gold,
we could
then send him up there, have him harvest the stone, and then that would...
We can't afford
expensive.
It. Yeah. So.
Decisions.
And we could do the encampment, which I did get the policy for, but that's a really nice campus spot. So maybe the encampment can go. Although, the encampment here might actually be good because.
Like,
with England
look at the nook of the curve of the river there. If you put an encampment in there,
like
that's
right
just
there.
Like so well protected.
Yeah. That actually, yeah, that would be really good.
That looks like a really nicely strategic spot.
So let's be, you know, a fickle autocrat and instead decide to go over here.
A mercurial autocrat?
No, it's never happened.
You do have a mercury resource there, so maybe that's why you're mercurial.
Yes. I'm drinking it because it'll make me live longer. Cool. So let's put an encampment here. Excellent. What kind of research should we do? So military tactics. Oh, okay. So not only do we have a technology boost for this because we killed a unit, one of those barbarians with those spearmen, but this will actually give us access to a really cool wonder, Huey Teocalli. So this wonder is really good if we're nearby lakes, which down here we happen to be. So Manaus, in addition to being really cool alternate history Amazon city, could have a nice wonder to boot. So I think I'm going to go towards this one.
Right.
And also give us a pikeman.
And the nice thing about that is not only do we have this perfect spot for it, but it's going to be less likely that some of the other civs will have the perfect spot for it.
Right.
So any of those wonders with very unique build location requirements, it's easier to jump ahead of the AI and get those in advance of them. So
yeah, because if other players don't have the lakes like we do,
right, then they just won't even have the opportunity to build that.
Yeah, and because we finished the civic there, that was one of the civics that gives us a free envoy, so we could actually jump up. We did the quest for Lisbon. We sent the envoy to Geneva last time, so now we have our pick of these three. We could become suzerain with, I believe, any of them. I don't think they're being competed for right now. Let's see if anyone else is here. No. Okay, so China has sent an envoy to Lisbon. But we want to keep going with Geneva here. They've got a pretty cool bonus. So, bam. All right, so now we are getting our suzerain bonus. It's not reflected in the UI in this build, but it highlights, and we get our plus 15% science as long as we're not at war with anyone. So the autocracy is turning over a new leaf. We're trying out this peace thing. You know, we're clearing out this barbarians, but now we have a very good reason to stay peaceful.
All right, we got a good chat question here from Jimmy B. Jimmy. Our city workable tiles still distance of 3, and our city settling distance is still 4.
Mm.
And those are correct. Actually, if you could turn on the settlement lens.
I was just going there. Yeah.
We can actually show sort of a new UI piece that we have that helps you with all those city settlement rules. While that settlement lens is on, any tile that is within 3 of a city, so not eligible for settling, gets color-coded with the red. So sort of as you're planning, we're at the point right now where we should be really thinking about what our third city is, and we can get a lot of insight into where would be good spots. The other thing to keep in mind is like oases, you're not allowed to build a city on them, so down in the lower left,
right,
there's one of those, and we can show that that's blocked out. And then the other thing this lens does is tell you how much water is available there, which sort of establishes your initial housing level. And basically anywhere adjacent to the oasis or along a river is going to have the best housing. Along the seacoast is sort of a moderate level of water availability.
Right.
But like right in the middle, not next to any water source, we just have this like kind of white color coding just to show that you can settle there, but you're going to be really strapped for housing right off the bat.
Right. And this lens comes up when we are moving around settler units once we're past our first settler of the game. So we can, very easily at a glance see, like, for example, this would be a really great spot because it's got a river. It's far enough away from London where we can still,
grab some time. I don't know. It might a little bit get Victoria.
I don't know if we would get any more trade agreements with England if we did that.
we might
get her angry. Yeah, but like this river around here is a really good spot. So yeah, a lot of different options here. All right, so let's have our spear. Oh yeah, our archer got in a little bit of trouble there because those horsemen move so fast. Let's try to lock him. Oh no, I was going to say we can bring our warrior up and try to protect our archer by locking him down with zone of control, but
I would move your archer back one and have him take a shot,
yeah,
and then you can put the spearman in front of him.
Yeah, kind of wall him off. That's a good point.
A lot of that same tactical interplay like this that Civ 5 had is really not changed much at all. Or you could just go ahead and finish them off because if you take that hex, it doesn't look like
you're gonna... this guy still would be able to sneak through. Normally, like our warrior and spearman would be able to exert a zone of control.
If you take that hex, then the zone of control would stop the horseman from getting through, but I think you're going to have to move next to the mountain and block.
Yeah, I think so too. Our missionary is ready, just about to continue spreading the good word here. All right. We're across the river, so maybe we can take a shot next turn. Scout here. All right. once after this.
Here's another interesting question.
Hello.
Ah.
I love all the feathers. This is one of my favorite leader scenes. A warrior or a coward? Don't you know anything about the Antonisocracy? I've been fighting barbarians all this time. It is an honor to meet you, sir.
Okay, he's gonna let us try our hand. I think at the ball game.
I think so too.
Not that great in my ancient Aztec, but I'm pretty sure that's what it's saying.
Sure, yeah, and because we're close to a city, we get the chance to come take a visit, which also reveals it on the map for us, which will be nice.
Yeah. Well, so it was worth pushing out there. And then notice that's not his capital.
That's not.
A second or third city that he's got.
Yeah.
I like to go ahead and set up a delegation and send him some gifts right away after meeting him.
That's a good point.
That goes ahead and gives us some diplomatic visibility, so you might want to do that.
Yeah, we have some gold to spare, so yeah, I think that's a good call. I'll just send a delegation to you. In a place of honor. Excellent.
Okay, and so now we can look at our relationship.
Yeah. So it's neutral. So yeah, we've sent him a delegation. Has a good first impression, which is kind of like a random factor. It depends on the game. But also, he doesn't like that we're an autocracy. Looks like he's in an oligarchy. So, you know, the difference in government has caused a little bit of tension, but we have enough goodwill going for us that it'll be okay. Later on, those tensions may increase more and more. So, yeah. What do we want to do with our next builder here? We can go, let's get a camp on this deer here. Okay. Man, there are barbarians everywhere. There's some iron here, too, man. And here. One of my favorite
That's a good
touches.
Point in the chat. They're suggesting that maybe Montezuma is the one who took our jungle pantheon.
Maybe
that's our long-term plan, is paying him back for that one.
Yeah. We can make a sacred path right to his empire with our spearmen.
Yes.
All right, so our wall was effective. Let's take some shots here. We have the auto camera cycling on. So we're doing pretty well against the barbarians here. Okay. Not quite. Let's do this. Keep defending the point for our archer there. Yeah, I don't see any rain. Oh, no, there's some rainforest up here. So, yeah, it might have been Montezuma who took it.
Yep.
Let's scout out his land. He's got some cotton. Okay.
Okay, so there's a question I wanted to answer. I alluded to about 5 minutes ago from Empires 96. And the question is, why aren't Brazil's colors the same as in the first look video?
Hmm.
And we've been explaining all along that we're playing a build that's about a month old.
Right.
Because we wanted to play the same build that the press has seen over their... press tour events that we've had across the world, and so this is basically a build that exactly matches what everyone's streaming today on the various YouTube channels and so forth.
Right.
And we have gone ahead, and this was before we sort of took every civ and we matched their colors to elements of either their historical flag or historical coat of arms. So we took another pass through all the civ colors after this build was put together.
Mm-hmm.
So if anyone sees like later live streams and so forth, they will see a lot of changes in Civ colors. This is actually, I think, Brazil's Civ colors just from Civ 5 ported over. But
we
looked at every single Civ again and tried to kind of take an even more careful job of matching colors with flags and coats of arms and things like that. So you'll see updates on that as we go forward.
Yeah, and in general, there's so many things about the game that are changing every day. Like, it's kind of like a little time machine or a time capsule going back and playing this from a month ago, just because there's so many things that I know have changed already. A lot of the values and the balance, you know, a lot of UI things that have gone in and have been polished, you know, like the Civ colors and stuff like that as well. But before too long, you will be playing the same version we are, and we will all be having fun together. Military tactics, will be just about done by the time we would hand over the succession. I'm not sure how we're doing on time. I don't know what the stoppage time is for the referee there.
Yeah, we'll have to get a ruling on that soon.
Yeah, let's have our scout heal. We can start working towards the Petra Wonder, because we are next to the desert. Again, this is not something everybody could work on, because you know, you have to have a desert tile to do it, as you do with the pyramids. But those are pretty big investments. I actually might, I don't know, our capital's kind of busy right now, but I might start working on either, we got an encampment going on up here, so either a campus or maybe maybe a settler to start pushing out the expansion. So I'm going to do a settler. In three turns, we can swap out and maybe do the policy that gives us bonus production towards settlers. But I'm going to get it started now. Just kind of like scout around with the archers. My place probably, if I had a settler right now, I'd probably either go... I like to forward settle. I'm kind of mean like that. That's how Anton Autocracy rolls a lot of the time. But yeah, like the river right here with some luxuries. Or yeah, again, that really ballsy position right next to London. Would be some of my picks, but also right in the middle here next to our capital.
Looks like there's some diamonds up there on the other side of the mountains through that place we've picked out for the campus that would give us access to a new type of luxury good.
Right, and yeah, we could have, even if we're not right on the river here, we could have an aqueduct that either links us to the river or the mountains. And
do we know yet whether Montezuma is happy with our luxuries that we have or whether we have some that he wants?
Well, let's check it out, actually. Yeah, that's a good point. Let's see if we can make a deal. So,
we have entirely different ones than he has.
We do.
So
yeah.
He's going to be not so happy about that soon. But yeah. Luckily, he's the leader that's the furthest away. I don't think we have to worry about anything imminent with him.
That's true. If we manage to curry his favor otherwise, like it could lead to some good trades. We only have the one Mercury, but we got a second cocoa coming online down here. So we could always use that as a commodity later on. Let's check out what's down here now. Oh, this is interesting. So, looks like Japan has had somebody trading with it from over here. So this is kind of like a neat moment where, you know, especially if you're exploring early on, like, there's somebody over here Japan's trading to. Maybe it's another Japanese city, maybe it's another civ that we haven't met yet. So we can sort of follow the road, and we get that movement bonus too, and kind of see where it goes.
Yep. There's definitely a key strategy to follow the ancient roads that you see on the map, and yeah. It almost always leads you to something interesting.
And I think that's just about time to turn it. Oh no, I didn't protect my trader.
Where would he get plundered?
Right between our, no, he was going to Lisbon, that's right. Yeah, I wasn't, yeah,
okay.
It looks like it right
so there.
There
are more barbarian problems between those city-states.
Yes, the military policies will have to stick around, perhaps. But, yeah. So that's turn 65, it's time to hand over the succession.
Okay, and I think this is the last time we're gonna do this because I think we have 5 minutes here. So, let's try to do some fun stuff in the last 5 minutes. And one thing that I'm looking at is there any way we can get our religion a little bit further? We need to get to theology.
Yeah, we need a temple.
So that would be 7 turns, and then we have to get a temple as well. Because that unlocks the next level of religious units that we haven't had a chance to show off.
The apostle, right.
Right, so... It's probably a stretch that we're going to get there, but we'll push forward as fast as we can. Let's shoot this guy while we have a chance. We'll hold off on the promotion. Promotion can be saved until later. We don't have to take it right away.
Oh, no. Someone said that the traitor's name was Sean Bean.
Well, that would explain things now, wouldn't it?
Barbarians are coming.
Yes. A barbarian winter. Okay, so we have to choose what we're going to produce in Rio. And let's replace our... We never did harvest that stone, right? So let's go show that.
No, the fickle autocrat decided an encampment was more important.
Okay, we'll get a builder going. And And just like any Sid Meier Civilization game, I know we're going to be out of time here, and we're going to have like six things that are about to happen.
But I want to wait till...
So we'll be like in the one more turn conundrum, but oh well. Oh, no wonder there's a barbarian problem. Look at that. There's a camp right there.
Camp's right there. Ah, oh, man, we were like scouting all around it.
Once again, our archer has too good a shot. He's going to have to hold off on getting promoted because he's just too busy killing guys.
Yeah. And you can, so like, the, another interesting thing about the promotions, you can save them, you know, if you really want to, like, a heal at a particularly good time. But while you have a promotion available, you don't earn any additional experience.
Right, and so I just got two kills there after I had already earned the experience points to level up.
Right.
Probably should have leveled up, but I wanted
but
to.
They're
horsemen, they can run away real quick.
Yeah, and because, yeah, if they were, you know, as melee units, if they get in our face, it's really bad as an archer. Oh. Japan and
our delegate, Gabrielle, who took that diplomatic delegation to Japan, finds out that Japan and Aztec are getting buddy-buddy. So there's this sort of coalition forming to our southeast that we're going to have to be worried about later.
There's a coalition in the Twitch chat that wants us to kill Japan.
So we did finish drama and poetry. We have a chance to switch out policies. Let's not switch governments. I'm going to just press forward here. Now we'll go ahead and pop this goody hut. And I'm not going to make an attack across a river. Yeah,
not
it's a major defeat. So
you could take this chance to promote.
Yeah, we actually had the tech to promote him to pikeman, but we're just not in home territory and don't quite have enough gold. So let's just go ahead and heal him. And now we finally get to promote this archer.
There we go.
And we will go with the volley promotion. And now this builder, what was our plan here? Another
I think he was gonna go
cocoa plantation?
We could do that, so we have it for trading with other folks.
The
deer,
get the deer on the way, maybe?
I think it does have a camp already. I think I did that.
Okay.
It's the downfall of having two different leaders.
Yeah.
But we could harvest that stone up by the nice campus spot.
Like
I think that's what we built.
The Roman Republic with two different consuls in charge back and forth.
Well, it's Tuesday, so I get to decide. You know, we are not attacking Hannibal. Oh, Namadol's trading with us, looks like. That's cool.
Ah, yes, we have a trader from the city-state coming in.
Yeah.
Wow, the barbarians are ballsy. They're leaving their camp
they
to
don't
attack
care about
us across
water.
The river and up a hill. Now, that's probably just going to help us. All right, so we are told it's 5:30 and it's time for us to wrap up our live stream, but we have absolutely enjoyed sharing a little Civ 6 with everybody, and we hope everyone continues to follow along as more information on Civ 6 gets announced and rolled out, and there's all sorts of videos and other content up there for people to be checking out throughout the week here.
Yeah, and there's always civilization.com, and we have some pretty active Twitter and Facebook feeds as well if you guys want to keep up to date on like the latest stuff.
Right. So it's been a pleasure. Thanks.